No queries. You guys were able to do all the questions. You got the answer that you were expecting.
Hello, ma'am.
Yes.
Ma'am, will you please elaborate the first program which you have given us?
The one that I gave you in your task?
Yes, ma'am.
All right. Let me check the question real quick. Wait a second. Yeah, so what you need to do in this one is, like, for the input, you have to ask the user for their salary and how many years of service have they done. If it's more than five, I'm guessing a company 5% to, if it's more than 5 years, then you need to give them a 5% bonus. So I'll just do it quickly. So let's do it over here. I hope this much part is clear. Like, we've made the scanner object and then I just ask them for the salary and ask them for the number of years. Both will be obviously like the integers. Salary can be in like of double type too, but I'm just taking it as int. All right. So I hope this part is clear. We are just asking user for values. And then we'll, we'll check like if years is greater than five. If the service is more than 5 years, then we need to give them 5% bonus, 5% on the salary. So let's just take a double type, let's call it bonus, and we'll calculate 5% of the salary. So it will be salary. If salary into, I'll just do a 0.05. I guess that will be it, right? 5 divided by 100 would be, yeah. See, somebody this is like perfectly fine. Like Naveen sir did it in the chat box. Like that's also a way of doing it. That's completely correct. You divided by 20, great. Because 5 upon 100 would be 20. And 5 upon 100 would also be that. And then we will add it to the salary, okay? So we can write salary is equals to salary plus bonus. Right? That's how you do it. And then we'll just print it. Println and just look at what we did over here. We are updating the value of salary. What like we are storing salary plus bonus inside the salary variable itself. I hope you guys like see this part, what I did. I wrote salary is equals to salary plus bonus. What will it do? It will take the value of salary, add bonus in it, and store it back into the salary variable. So now when I'll use salary, it will give this updated value. So let's try running it. I hope it works. Is there a problem? Error didn't make any mistake. Let's just try running it. Cannot convert from double to int. Wait a second. I just need this. Wait a second, I think I've written something wrong. If you guys catch it, then let me know. Yeah, did somebody see what the error is? I think there's.
I'm at ninth line.
Yeah.
You write
Oh, yes. Okay.
yes.
Great, thank you. Yeah, it works now. So it's asking for the salary. So let's just enter 100 to get like an easier result, and the service years will be, let's keep it less than 5 first, and it will do nothing. See, it did nothing because we did not put any else part, right? We are just printing it when it is greater than 5. If it's less than 5, nothing happens. And let's run it again. And let's take100, and this time I would say 6 years, and we got 105. All right, let me just again tell you what mistake I made before was I took salary as int, but over here I tried adding it with a double value. So it was, you know, changing into a double, but as before I declared salary as int type, it was only having 4 bytes of space, but we were trying to store something which took 8 bytes. So that cannot happen. That's why it was showing the error of type mismatch. All right. So that's what you need to keep in mind when you're coding. Like I took it as int and thought like, okay, I'll just give an integer value over here. But when I was calculating, it was converting into a double value. When I, you know, multiplied it with 0.05 and I tried adding bonus because bonus was double, and was converting into a double value, that's why it was giving an error. So we should keep it in mind that the type should be matching. They should not mismatch. I hope it's clear now. Shweta ma'am, you asked, right? Do you understand what's happening? Is it clear?
Yes, ma'am, understood.
Okay, great. Anybody else have any problem?
Ma'am, can we insert real-time date?
Can we insert what? Can you please repeat yourself?
Real-time date.
What do you mean by real-time date?
It means today's date.
Oh, get the current date in Java? Yeah, there are functions that you can use to get the current date.
Okay, ma'am.
Like we will move when we start actually, you know, making websites and making apps, that's where we actually would be using those. So Java has a lot of things predefined, like I even told you before, like even for calculating or getting these kind of values, getting system values, like when you make apps, you can, like, they already defined stuff that you can use to get, you know, what is your mobile's current date on which the app is running, or you can use it to get, you know, what is the theme the mobile is using. Is it using dark theme or the light theme? You don't have to code it yourself. It's already there. So as we move forward, once you're done with the basics, we will go ahead and see all of that. So do you guys want to ask something else, or I should start teaching new stuff?
No, ma'am.
Okay, so one more thing, like before I forget about it, I think you guys, like whoever joined the meeting in the afternoon or like even didn't do it, you must have seen like this, there's this upcoming webinar. And it's like, it's a good thing, like you will get like certification and stuff for that. And if you take part in the quiz, you can even like win and get a really nice certificate. Those are like ISO certified, like those are not just like random certificates that, you know, people host random webinars and seminars and give away random certificates. These are like officially, you know, certified. It will have value to it. Like if you get that certificate, it's valuable because it's like backed by a good organization. So, and it's like a good thing that CareerDreams Education have those kind of, you know, they have been recognized at these places. So those certificates do hold value. So if you guys want to be a part of it, that would be really cool. And you can like register for it. Ask your friends if anybody wants to be a part of it. These kind of certificates do count when you put it in your resume. They count as, you know, extra work, extracurricular kind of work that you've been a part of, you know, like you don't only have knowledge in a certain domain. It's like over a larger one, like, okay, you know, Java, you know, web development, or, you know, app development, but you're not only stopping over there. You also have some knowledge of, you know, other fields. So it's nice to have these kind of certificates. They show the diversity of your education. They even show that you are able to understand different kind of work if given. So think about it. I think it's a great opportunity that it's happening, and I would actually encourage you to be a part of it. And if you want to be, your friends want to be, or anybody you know or whoever, you can fill that up and, you know, register for that. So now I'll just start with the class. So we did not do switch case yesterday, right? We didn't do this, or did we do it?
No, ma'am.
Yeah. So we'll start with switch case. So like we use, you know, your if and else, and then we did ternary operators. You guys remember we did ternary operators yesterday. So switch case is also for decision making. When you need to check something, you need to make a decision. Like in if you're making a decision, if this thing is true, do this, otherwise do that. So what happened, how this works is, this is, I've written a simple program. Now, okay, I'll just explain in a different way that I think that would be more easier. When you use if, what happens, you write if certain condition, something happens, else if, you can use else if to add one more condition, or you can use a nested ifs. But it becomes pretty complicated after a point. If you put like, you know, you have to put like 12 conditions, so you have to, you know, check a large number of values. It kind of gets like very complex and confusing. That's where you can use switch case. Like if your program logic allows, it's a good way of, you know, checking a huge number of conditions at like one place. So how it works right now, I've written a program where we're going to ask user to enter number between 1 and 7. And whatever number they enter, according to that, we'll print the day of the week. All right. So if you think about the logic behind getting a number from the user and printing the day of the week, what's the logic? If they print 1, you need to give Monday. 2, you need to give Tuesday. 3 is Wednesday. So you need to check for everything, right? You need to check like if the number that user enter equals to 1, print Monday. If it equals to 2, print Tuesday. If it equals to 3, print this. If it's equal to 4, print Thursday. So that's like a lot of if statements and a lot of complexity. So in that case, we just use switch case. It's called switch case because we literally use switch and case. So the syntax is you write, first you write switch. S should be small. It has a small s. Then you put brackets and you write the variable which you want to check. Okay, you put the variable which you want to check. Now this, what it will do, it will match the value of whatever's in here to everything that's after the case. So case one doesn't mean case number one. Case one means it will check, is the number equals to 1? If it is, it will print Monday. Is the number equal to 2? Then it will print Tuesday. Is the number equal to 3? It will print Wednesday. I'll take other examples too. You can even have strings over here. You can have characters. You can have, you know, any kind of data type. But what this means is, like, it could have been something like, you can have like a case A. Now, what it will do, it will check, is the value of number A? Is the value of number A? If it is, then it will execute what's over here. But right now we have an integer type, so we'll just keep it at 1. So how it works, it comes over here, it sees switch, gets the number, users enter a number, then it will come inside, it will read case 1. So it will check if is the value of number 1. If it is, then it will execute these lines. It will print Monday, and as soon as it reads break is a jump statement. What does that mean? Wherever break can be used without switch case, it can be used anywhere in a program. It could be used with, you know, your loops, or it can be used with your if as well if it's needed. As soon as the program reads break, it gets out of this whole switch thing. All right, it comes over here. As soon as it reads break, it comes outside. It doesn't read any of that. It leaves everything and goes outside. So how does it help us as programmers? It helps us because as soon as it gets, you know, it gets to the point where the condition becomes true, it will not read anything else after it because that's not needed. If the program is actually reading the rest of the statements, it's just useless. You don't need that to happen, right? So if the number was 1, it would come inside here, print Monday, reads break, it will just go out, program will end. If it was not 1, let's say it was 3, so it will come inside, it will read case 1, no, it's not case 1, so it will come here. It will read case 2, no, the number is not 2, it will ignore all of it, come over here. Will read 3, is it? Yes, it is equal to 3, it will come over here, print Wednesday, and then it will read break and get out. All right. So that's how you write all of the cases. We've written till 7 Sunday. Then we have a default case. what is default case? Let's say the value, this value, whatever it was not equal to any of these numbers. It was not 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. It was like something else. It was 10. The user just put 10 for fun. All right. Users can do that. You ask them for something between 1 and 7. They decided, no, we're not going to do that. We're going to put something else and see what happens. So they just entered 10. What will the program do then? If it's not equal to any of this, it will go to the default case and just print not in range. So you can do whatever the program wants you to do, right? You can change this. You can have something else. So it goes into the default when the value didn't match any of the given values. So it will just go inside the default, print this, and just get out. All right, let's try running it. I did not try running it. Let's see. I think it should work. Didn't get time to do it beforehand today. I hope this you guys can see the code. Do you want me to zoom in? Okay, no. So it asks for number between 1 to 7. Let's try putting 3. It gives us Wednesday. All right. Let's try running it again and give a different number. Let's try 4. Gives you Thursday, what we expected. Let's try running it with the, you know, number which is not between 1 and 7. Let's give it 8 and gave us not in range. All right, you guys understand this? You guys understand what's happening? Does anybody want to ask something?
Ma'am?
Yes.
What's the role of default statement in this program?
What's the use of
default
statement. Okay. Yes. See, user entered a number. When you are asking user to enter something, you can never expect them to give you the, like, always give you the right, you know, value. You told them to enter number between 1 and 7, but there might be a case when they will either by mistake or just for fun or whatever enter a number which is not between 1 and 7. Right? They might enter a number which is not between 1 and 7. So then what will happen? In that case, what should the program do? When it started checking, let's say when we entered 8, switch got the number 8 over here, right? Numbers value was 8. It came over here, saw case 1. Was it 1? No. Is it 2? No. 3? No, it's not 3. It's not 4. It's not 5. It's not 6. It's not 7. Then what will it do? So it will get inside the default over here. It's not compulsory to have a default, all right? If I don't have this part, then the program will do nothing. It will just, you know, give you a blank screen. It will just do nothing. But it's nice to display it on the screen, you know, that your number was not in range or, you know, like it just didn't work. Like you gave something wrong. That's when we use the default. Or it is like this part of the program, this part of the switch case works when all of these cases become false. All right. So you can make use of it in a smart way and do your make a program do something. Like, you know, there was some. If I give you an example. Like you can have you maybe like if there's a question in which you need to do something when none of the case is matched, like let's say if the case didn't match, you need to make this certain calculation. So you can make your default do that. But basically why it is used is when none of the case matches, like we did when we entered 8. So it gets inside the default and executes whatever's inside the default. All right.
Yes, ma'am.
I hope it became clearer and not, you know, more confusing. Anybody else wants to ask something? Then I'll talk more about the switch case. There's like other parts to it too. If you are clear till what just happened, if you guys understood how this program of printing the days worked, then let me know if you understood. Let me know if you did not understand.
Ma'am,
it's clear? Okay. Yes.
Can we use conditions in switch case?
Can you put a condition over here? No. Yeah. No, you cannot have like something like greater than or less than. No, you just give a value, and that value is matched with this. Like whatever's over here, that will be matched with this. So it just checks for equals to. You cannot have like something greater than something or something less than something. No.
Okay, ma'am.
Yeah. Anybody else wants to ask something? Okay, so I'll just move forward now. Right, so let's see what will happen if we don't put this break over here. This is also important. See, right now we are taking these. Somebody said something in the chat. Can we use function in switch case? Can we use function? You mean methods? Like by function, what I understand is like main is a function. Do you mean that? No, why would you put a function inside switch case? No, you cannot. See, functions are, I think you asked it before too. What methods do is, or functions do is, they just wrap your code, like, right? It's like kind of a wrapper and it keeps your code in like one section. Like, let's see it like that way, all right? So you cannot have a function inside a function. This switch case is inside main, right? So if you'll put a function inside of that function will be inside main. So you cannot do that. And there's like absolutely no need to do that. You can call a function, like you had a separate function somewhere in your program and you want to give it a call. You can do that. You cannot define, you cannot write a function inside of it. Functions are supposed to be inside class. Like inside this class, you have main function. Like that, inside this class, you can have here you can have another function if you want. You can have like a void apple or something, right? Like this is fine. You can do this, but you cannot write this inside the main, or you cannot write another function inside it. Functions are supposed to be separate. No functions should be, inside another function. Yeah, that's like an important point. Keep that in mind. All right. Anything else? If you guys have any other query, any doubt, ask it. Because if you keep, especially in the tech world, if you keep half knowledge or if you keep, not complete knowledge, then it would be like harmful when you code because you would be doing something wrong for sure. So it's nice to be clear about everything. So you guys. I'm like considering that you guys understood how we asked a user to enter a number, and according to that number, we printed a certain day. Right? Okay, so I'll move ahead. What we're gonna do now is I will show you. This break is also not compulsory. Like, if you don't have a break, the program will still work, but it will do. It will not give you an output that you were expecting. What break does is, as soon as the program reads break, it exits the switch case, right? It exits the switch case. It will come like outside the quiz switch case. It will not come outside the program. It will just come outside the switch case. Okay. But if there's no break, then what will it happen? It will keep on reading all the cases. As soon as it will find a case that is true, as soon as it will find a case that is true, like it found like case one is true, number is one, and it matches one, it will execute all the cases after that. Okay. Let's say the user entered the number one, it will come inside, it will say, okay, one is true. So it will print Monday. As there is no break, it will also print Tuesday. And then it will see that there is a break and it will exit. Let me show you what I mean by that. Let's save this and see if I enter one, it printed Monday, also printed Tuesday. Why? Because there was no break. Because there was no break. Now let's say I remove. I put this break back. And what I'll do is I'll remove this break statement. Now let's remove this one. Let's see what happens now. Now, if I enter 1, it prints Monday, and I'm going to run it again. And I'm going to give it 3, right? Because I removed such cases. So it printed Wednesday, Thursday, Friday. Why? Because after 3, it said, okay, 3, this case is matching. It printed Wednesday. There was no break. It printed Thursday. There was no break. It printed Friday. Then they found a break and exited the switch case. Do you guys follow this? Do you guys understand this?
Yes, ma'am. Understand.
Okay, very nice. What about others? If you guys, it's a little bit confusing. If you guys are confused, let me know. Because this is important. You can make use of this in your favor. Can we call method?
Ma'am, why we are using switch case, ma'am?
Why are we using switch case? Because see, if you do not use, see, okay, that's a good question. Like, let me explain it to you once more. What are the other options we have? We have if, the other option right now, according to what we have learned, we have if case, not if, if statement. We can use it like, we can say, if number equals to 1, print Monday, else if number equals to 2, print this. Else if number equals to 3, print that. Else if it equals to 4, print that. So that's so many of, like, so many ifs that you're writing, so many conditions that you're putting. First of all, you're increasing the size of the code that you're writing. Also, as the compiler has to go through so many conditions, it's reading if this, this, then do this. If this, this, then do that. That's also taking a lot of, you know, the compiler's time. Through switch, we are able to make that kind of decision easily. We can use switch case when we have to only, you know, match the inputted value to something and, you know, print something, especially if there's like a large number of decisions that used to be made, that needs to be made, right? So all of these things, there are alternatives. You can use if else to do it. Like, nobody's stopping you to do it. But you need to pick the right option, the right thing, which is for you according to the program that you're writing, which would be the best, you know, element that you can use to make something work. For switch, you know, in this case, for print, checking if a number is from 1 to 7, something like between 1 to 7, printing a day, switch is the best choice you can make, right? Because you have to just write these cases and this print statements. It will itself ignore everything else. It even gives you like the default option. So that's why we are using it over here. Also, as we just saw, like how when you do not write the break part, it just executes everything after a certain case. You can also make use of this, you know, in your favor. Like, let's say you have to make the user enter a month and print, like, you know, how many months it will be, like spring or summer. So let's say if they enter January, you should be printing like January, February for winter, because those are the 2 months left. So you can like ignore the break part and like it will just print both at the same time. So it will like be more clear when you start working on questions, when you start thinking about it yourself, when you think and apply it, you will understand like, okay, that's why I'm doing it. I hope you understand now why we are using switch case.
Yes, ma'am, clear.
Yeah, so it's so that you're not making too many, first of all, not writing a very long code, you know, not doing a lot of typing. And you're also decreasing the size of your code and not making too many decisions for no reason when they're not even needed. So, all right. Does anybody want to ask something else? Functions and methods is the same thing, Sakshi ma'am. You said in the chat box, can we call method in switch case? Method and function is the same thing. Functions, you call it in like C, C++, and Java, we call functions method. So main is a method and function is the same thing. Anybody wants to ask something else? You guys understood how on removing break it will just execute every case after the right one. Like as soon as it matches with the case, it'll print everything else after it if there is no break. There's no break. Anybody wants to ask something?
No, ma'am.
Okay, great. So I'll move forward now. I'll give you questions related to such for today's assignments that when you'll do it yourself, you will understand it more. You will understand when to use break, when not to use break. Try, playing around with the switch case. Try, what will happen when I remove this break? What will happen when I remove the other break or something? Try doing it and you will understand it way more. So now I'm gonna move ahead to loops. So anybody has idea of using loops? Anybody has lo used loops before in any other language? Yeah, so can you tell why do we use loops? Why are loops used? Okay, so I'll just tell you guys, it's fine. We use loop when exactly like it's in the name. When you loop something, when you loop music over in your music player in Spotify, it like goes over again and again, right? Like it starts again and again. That's when we use loop. When we used to do, when we need to do a certain, execute certain number of statements for a number of times. Let's take an example. Let's say, get rid of this. We need to print numbers 1 to 10. Right now, without loops, can somebody tell me how will you print numbers 1 to 10? Like if I give you a program, write a program to print numbers 1 to 10. What are you gonna do? How are you gonna print numbers 1 to 10? You can just like unmute yourself and just tell me.
Simply, we can write system dot out dot println 1 to 10 number.
Yeah. It reduces so much of code. Yes, right. Yeah, so if right now I ask you to print 1 to 10, what are you gonna do? You're gonna write system.print1, system.print2, system.print3, system.println4. If you need to print them in different lines, or you can just write system.println 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 9, 10. Right? That's the only way of doing it. But if you want in separate lines, then you're going to write it again and again. You're going to write system.println 1, system.println 2, system.println 3. So for loops, what it's going to do, it's going to reduce like a huge amount of your work. It's going to execute that one statement, system.println, 10 times for you. I'll just show you the first loop we are doing. There are like different kinds of loop. We are doing the for loop, and what the sort like the main syntax, like how it works, is you have for, and then you need to put a variable. So you have, let me first write it for you. Say I. I'll first write it and then I'll explain it to you. That's easier. Yeah. Token I. Why? Okay. So in the for loop, we've taken a variable entire over here. We gave it no value. Okay, it has no value right now. After that, what we did, we checked. We initialized I. The first part of for loop is initialization. Then you have the condition, and then you have updation. We have initialization, then we have the condition, and then we have updation. So how it works? First, it like reads for, comes inside. Then we need to give a value which will be, you know, which will help us run the loop, which will tell us, you know, what number of loop it is. So we're gonna start with 1, we can start with 0, we can start with 100, whatever you want. Like it should just be, you know, increasing or decreasing later on for the loop to work. You can have whatever number. So we're gonna initialize a value. So we wrote I equals to 1. And then we said I is less than equal to 10. This was a condition. Why? Because I's value should keep on increasing till what? Till 10. That's how many numbers we want, right? We need to print 1 to 10. And after that, we said I plus plus. So every time the loop works, I will be increased by 1. Let's, you know, see it. Like, let's try running it manually. Like, I'll just tell you. Let's say we have I and we're going to write whatever value it will be. We're going to try running it ourselves. And what I mean, this is called dry run. You can use this technique to, you know, check if you're making any mistake or not. What we're going to do initially, what's the value of I? We said I equals to 1. So I's value is 1, right? It said I's value is 1. And then it checked the condition. Is I less than equal to 10? Is it? Yes or no?
Yes, ma'am.
Right. It is less than equal to 10. So it will come inside. The first time the loop runs, it does not see this updation part. Okay, it just sees initialization and it checks the condition. The condition was true. It will come inside. It will print system.out.println the value of I. What's the value of I? It will print 1. Okay, once it has printed 1, it will reach the end of the loop. But it will not exit it. It will go back up. It will go back up. And this time it will enter from this side. When it started from here, right? It checked I equals to 1, checked the condition, went inside. Printed the value of I. Now it will enter from here and will first increase the value of I by 1. So what will it become? It will become 2 now. I's value is 2. And then we'll check the condition. Is it less than equal to 10? Yes, it is. It will come inside. Now it will not read this part. It will just read these two. It will come inside. It will print 2. Reaches the end of loop, goes back up. Increases the value of I by 1, becomes 3. Is 3 less than 10? Yes, prints 3. Increases it again, you know, goes back up, makes it 4, prints 4. Comes back, you know, goes back up, increases by 1, becomes 5. It is less than equal to 10, prints 5, goes back again, 6, prints 6, 7, 8. Then when it prints 9, goes back up, make it 10. I's value becomes 10, checks the condition. Is I less than equal to 10? Yes, it is. It is equal to 10. It will come down again, print 10, go back up. But this time, the 10 became 11. The value will become 11, and 11 is not less than equal to 10. So it will exit the loop. Like this thing will now stop. It will stop working and the control will come over here. The compiler will get out of the loop. So let me try running it. And I think it should work. It is showing me, why is it showing me errors? See? It printed from 1 to 10. Can you guys see this? From 1 to 10. And I can make it do anything. I can make it print from 5 to 10. What I just need to do is start the loop from 5. It just works on the logic. You need to think before, you know, what values you want the loop to print. So accordingly, you need to set this value and your condition and, you know, your updation value. So now if I'll run it, it will give me 5 to 10. See, it gave me 5 to 10. I can make it print, you know, after skipping, instead of skipping one value, make it skip two value. You can do that. You can write I equals to I plus 2. I plus 2, I'm sorry. Instead of I plus plus, we can write I plus 2. By the way, I plus plus is the same thing as writing I equals to I plus 1. If anybody got confused over there, I plus plus is nothing. It's just a shorthand, a short way of writing. I is equals to I plus 1. Instead of writing I plus 1, you can just write I plus plus. So, and updating, I hope you guys, everybody understands what I mean by updating is. You are writing I equals to I plus 2, so you're updating the value of I. Right? After this, the value of I changes. So, if you guys understand the meaning of updating. So I'll run it now and see, it gave me 5 and then 6, 7 and 8, 9. It was skipped 2 and didn't print 10 because when it was skipping 2, after 9 plus 2 became 11 and 11 was not, you know, it made the condition false. Are you guys understanding what I'm trying to say?
Ma'am?
Yes?
Why you're showing like 5, 7, 9 might skip the 8th number.
Why it skipped number 8?
Yes, ma'am.
Because I made this I is equals to I plus 2 over here. See? I was showing like how you can make it skip two numbers and not skip a single, like first, let me print it with from 1 itself. We are printing 1 to 10, right? Like it was skipping one number. It was going like 1, 2, 3, 4. We can make it like see, first what we were doing was we printed 1 to 10 normally, just 1, after that plus 1, 2, plus 1, 3. Now, when I made it I is equals to I plus 2, instead of moving ahead by one number, it started adding 2. So it printed 1 and 1 plus 2 would be 3 and then it would be 5, 7 and 9.
Yes, ma'am, understood. And is there any need to print the value of I also means int I?
No, you can have, it doesn't need to be, you're asking if it needs to be a number every time. It needs to be integer every time, that's what you're asking me?
Yes, ma'am.
You can have double values, but just you know, keep in mind like your calculations. I'm sorry, what these numbers are used for, what all of this is used for deciding how many iterations the loop will make. What does iteration means? How many times the loop will work, how many times it should loop, how many times it should go back. Like when we were doing from 1 to 10, it was looping 10 times, right? From 1 to 10, this whatever was inside was working. If I would have, when we started skipping by 2, now instead of working 10 times, it's just working 5 times. You guys understand that, right? When I was doing I plus 1, it was working 10 times. The loop worked 10 times and printed 1 to 10. Now when I started skipping numbers by 2, it worked only 5 times because it printed only 5 values, right? You guys understand that? If somebody didn't, yeah, did you understand that? Yes. Yes.
That is not what I'm asking. My question is, if we are printing the value of I is equals to 1 in for loop, so is there any need also to type the value that is I is equals to 1 beside the int? Means on the upper side of for.
Okay, so you're asking if I write this, then is there a need for writing this again? Like, why can't I write this?
Yes, ma'am, exactly.
No, you need to give it over here because this part needs to be an initialization. The syntax of for loop is the first part before the semicolon is the initialization. Then we have your condition, and then we have the updation. The initialization part is important because we are telling for loop that start from I equals to 1 and then do everything else. You can skip the condition and updation part. I will go, over it like tomorrow. But this part is important because for loop needs to know from where it will start. If you don't write this, it doesn't know from where to start. First, you need to tell it like loop start from 1. If I make it 2, it will start from 2. Okay, so I can write this and it will start from 2. So, just run it. See, now it started from 2 and printed till 10. Okay,
Yes.
so you need to tell the loop from where it should start. It can start from 100, it can start from any other number, it can start from wherever you want. So that's what it is. I hope this is clear. Let me know if you guys are confused in this part. We'll talk more about for loop and other kind of loops tomorrow.
Ma'am, if we are incrementing a number by 1, so we can also
Yeah.
write I plus 1 also, no?
Yes, we you can write yeah, you can writing
Instead of
I
I
equals to
plus
I,
plus.
yeah. I is equal to I plus 1 is same as I plus plus. You can write whatever. You can write I is equals to I divided by something. You can do whatever calculation you want, but it should be something in I equals to I something, right? You can write I equals to I into 1. You can do this if you want. But I equals to I, this is important because the value of I should be updated. If it's not getting updated, the loop will not end because in every time it will. Okay, I'll talk about it tomorrow. That will be like it's a bit complex. Not complex, I'll give you examples and then you will understand what I'm trying to say. So you can have whatever you want over here. You just need to update the value of I. That's the point. Anybody wants to ask something?
No, ma'am.
Okay. Anybody else? If you guys don't have
No,
any
ma'am.
more queries, okay, great. So if you guys don't have any more queries, we'll just end the session over here. I'll send you the task in some time. We'll be sending you the programs, and thank you so much. You guys can start leaving the class.